Welcome to Cruz Lake Wilderness Park. Located in Central Pasco County, this park covers a good 113 acres of land west of the Cruz Lake. But I'm not here to camp for a night or two. I'm here because of this.
Within the park lies the 7.5-inch gauge Central Pasco and Gulf Railroad. Established as a 501 nonprofit in 2006, this railroad operates public runs on the second Saturday of each month. At nearly 3 miles of track, this railroad is close to Ridge Live Steamer's main line's length, but not as big as Big Boots and Western, which is the largest 7.5-inch gauge railroad in the state of Florida. The railroad is modeled after the section of Pieter Diemen's Orange Belt Railroad, a 3-foot gauge line which used to run through here before being bought out by Henry Plant in 1895, with the track between Trilby and Sanford being re-gauged to standard gauge to add to his own railroad system's track mileage, this being the Plant system. The Plant system would eventually become a part of the Atlantic Coast Railroad in 1902. But you might be wondering, why am I here today? Well, I did mention in the last Discover Alive Steam Winter Meet video that I might be coming here for their winter meet. And that's exactly why I'm here today. And man, do we have a selection of steam locomotives this time. And fueled by all the fuels. Wood, coal, propane, and even battery-driven steam outlines. When I arrived, the engines that would be running were already getting prepped for the day. Water tanks filled, fires ignited, and even some cleaning out of the boiler tubes on some of the engines. In particular, this coal-fired 062.
Blow right through it. That one is small. Well, it's small enough, so obviously.
One of the most interesting steamers out and about was this, an 042 named Babe. One cool aspect of this engine was this, a fully functioning Westinghouse air brake system. There was even a Shea present at the event.
Up on the roof. Let the meat rot off.
First one out of the bays, though, was Jim's number 20, which Santino drove into the yard to collect its consist for the day. One thing to note was the day DLS had the winter meet here, Pasco was also having its public runs on the same day, so there was a variety of trains running on the main line, hauled by the 2, later 3, diesels. Soon, I went to scout for locations to film the trains, with some help from the volunteers at Pasco, as prior to this, I had actually never been to their line before. And before I forget, thank you so much for helping me out here. I really appreciate it.
Thank you.
One of the best spots for rail fanning was Timmins Trestle. Watching engines roll by on the trestle was quite the sight. An important part of Pasco's line is the fully functioning block signaling system. The route is divided into several blocked sections, with color light signals on each section, including the pass-by loops. About an hour later, I headed back to the yard to eat the lunch I packed for the day.
What's this? The wood burner's out.
After their respective laps around the route, steam engines would stop at Sanford Yard to take on water. Their crews would also take on their food and water as well. It was also time for a particular engine to be steamed up and coupled up to its consist. But I'll get to that later. Santino was also finished with his turn on number 20 when he got back, so he fetched his D&H box cap that he also brought to the event that day. I, meanwhile, hopped aboard a goods train and took a trip down the line. The 7.5-inch gauge engines weren't actually the only vehicles operating that day either. Over at a miniature road vehicle track next to the yard, I found two guys playing with their miniature traction engines. One of them even had this, an O-gauge Mammoth 040.
I have the cam research whistle.
That doesn't really work.
Yeah. A few minutes later, I joined Santino and a friend of his as we walked up the line to do some more rail fanning. Now, you might have noticed that there's the one particular engine that I'm leaving out to some degree. That engine is this. You have been waiting for this moment, right? Well, watch this. Up until this point, I had only seen this engine in photographs of it at Largo. Seeing it perform here was an absolute blast. I must thank the owner of this 844 for allowing me to attach one of my cameras so that I could get the shots of the valve gear in motion. That was spectacular to see it up close like that. But that wasn't the only fun part of the day I had.
Yeah.
Yes, Batman let me drive the Bat Tracker for a lap around the route. Of course, the day soon came to an end. Most of the steam engines were then cleansed of their fires and put back in the steaming bays. Overall, it was a fantastic day out there in Pasco. It speaks wonders that the heritage that exists with live steam is very much apparent in events like this, as you get a glimpse of what it was like back in the age of steam. They may be smaller scale replicas of the real things, but it goes to show that even when scaled down, the way these engines are operated remains similar. And the sight of one of these engines going in full chat at scale speeds of 50 to 60 miles an hour, which is close to 5 miles per hour in real life, is a sight to behold, and one that, in my mind, will never get old as time goes on.